Chapter 1621. Thump. An irregular character appeared on the ground. This was the figure of Arahang. Tang Wulin was completely dumbstruck by this sudden turn of events. He simply couldn't understand what had just happened. After handing Sima Jingkai over to Yali for treatment, he hurried over to the crater in the ground and pulled Arahang out of it. Arahang possessed far superior physical resistance compared to Sima Jingkai, but his battle armor was also quite damaged, and there were many charred patches on his body as well. Tang Wulin wore a speechless expression as he asked, "What happened, senior disciple brother?" Arahang turned to Tang Wulin with a resigned expression. "At the time, I was thinking, how could a woman be so ugly? And I hugged her." Yura, Tang Wulin really wanted to throw him back into the crater after hearing his thoughts. Sima Jingkai's thoughts were most likely much the same. Thus, Spirit Academy won the first 2-on-2 match, but it was a completely inexplicable victory. The Shrek Academy duo had been dominating their opponents, and victory was literally within their grasp, but they had suffered a stunning defeat, and Sima Jingkai was severely injured, so he clearly couldn't participate in the final 7-on-7 match. How did this happen? Tang Wulin had been very confident in this pair. Sima Jingkai and Arahang were constantly bickering with one another, but they had actually been cultivating together for a very long time, and despite their argumentative relationship, they had a high level of tacit understanding with each other. As such, they were able to confuse the opponent, then display their exemplary teamwork when it mattered. On top of that, both of them possessed hyper Douluo level powers, so individually, they were actually more powerful than some members of Shrek's 7 monsters. Kaiyangyu Dongfan's expression was also very peculiar. He had also been very confident in the Vice Sisters, and his heart had completely sunk when Sima Jingkai had sealed all light elements. He was well aware of just how powerful ephemeral light was. This was a soul fusion skill that was close to the limit Douluo level in power, and even if he were to come up against it, he would only be able to passively defend until they ran out of soul power. Once the two of them became hyper Douluo, their soul fusion skill would truly reach the limit Douluo level, thereby making them an important trump card for the Spirit Pagoda. But who could have predicted that there would be an opponent capable of sealing light to such a complete extent? Without their soul fusion skill, the Vice Sisters were far less formidable. Almost all of their practical combat training had been done with their soul fusion skill, and it would be a great pity if they were to be defeated under these circumstances. However, who could have imagined that two screams would suddenly turn the tables? Even though the match had been won, Kaiyangyu Dongfang wasn't feeling very happy. By Hauser and Bao Tyson descended in front of Kaiyangyu Dongfang, and they were still speaking in their female voices as they said in unison, "Gentlemen." Almost everyone from the Spirit Pagoda around Kaiyangyu Dongfang had taken an unconscious step backward. Just as Arahang had said, these were two rugged and burly men, but they possessed female voices that were very pleasing to the ears. It was truly quite disturbing. Kaiyangyu Dongfang's eyelids twitched as he said, "You did very well. Go and rest now." "Yes." Bai Hauser cast her gaze toward the unconscious Sima Jingkai, while Bai Tyson turned toward Arahang. In response to Bai Tyson's surreptitious glance, Arahang's eyes immediately rolled back into his head, and he also fell unconscious, although it was unclear whether he was acting or not. Tang Wulin almost gave him a slap to his bald head as he said in a low voice, "Are you an idiot? Can't you see she's in disguise? The Spirit Pagoda must have disguised their original appearance so they could be used as future trump cards." Arahang immediately reopened his eyes upon hearing this. "Is that true?" Tang Wulin rolled his eyes, and replied, "Why would I lie to you about something like this?" Arahang scratched his head in a slightly embarrassed manner as he said, "The situation just now really caught me off guard. It was all Sima Jingkai's fault. We had already prepared to land the final blows, but who would have thought that his stupid light seal would suddenly cut off? We wouldn't have lost if he hadn't been so useless." Sima Jingkai had already awakened while receiving Yali's treatment, and he immediately flared up with rage upon hearing this. "Bullshit. How is it bullshit? Am I not correct to pin the blame on you? You had already caught your opponent in a full embrace. If you had eliminated her, it would have been 2-on-1, and our victory would have been assured. You're one to talk. Why didn't you knock your opponent unconscious? If you had knocked out your opponent, my opponent wouldn't have been able to pose any threat to me. That's enough. Go and bicker in the back." Tang Wulin was left feeling completely speechless. This was the first match that had completely spiraled out of his control. Thankfully, he still had enough up his sleeve to give Kaiyangyu Dongfang a massive surprise. Thus, he turned to Kaiyangyu Dongfang with an exasperated expression, and said, "I didn't think you'd stoop to these tricks, Gemin Kaiyangyu. Is your Spirit Academy offering disguise classes?" Kaiyangyu Dongfang knew that Tang Wulin was mocking him, and he replied in an indifferent manner, "The outcome has already been decided. Let's continue. You're currently losing by 3 points. If we win the final 2-2-on-2 matches, then there will be no need for the final 7-on-7 match." Tang Wulin smiled, and said, "I'm afraid I'll have to rain on your parade. I'm going to be appearing in the next match. I hope you'll organize sufficiently powerful opponents for me." Kaiyangyu Dongfang's eyes narrowed slightly upon hearing this. He had never dared to look down on Tang Wulin. Tang Wulin's rate of progression was downright astounding, and it seems that he was constantly evolving. Aside from Yuna, he was the most exceptional young soul master that Kaiyangyu Dongfang had ever seen. Yi Xinglin and Yuan and Yui had both put on stunning displays, yet he was the leader of Shrek's 7 monsters and the current Sea God's Pavilion Master, and that was sufficient testament to his abilities. Kaiyangyu Dongfang was wondering who his partner for this 2-on-2 match was going to be. The current score was 6-3, and Spirit Academy had double Shrek Academy's points. Just as Kaiyangyu Dongfang had said, if Shrek Academy were to lose both 2-on-2 matches, then there would be no need for this clash to continue as a lead of 5 points would be unassailable. Thus, the next 2-on-2 match would be extremely important for Shrek Academy. If they were to lose again, then they would be piling immense pressure upon themselves. Who was Tang Wulin's partner going to be? Everyone's eyes were on him. Meanwhile, two people emerged from the Spirit Pagoda camp behind Kaiyangyu Dongfang. One of them patted Kaiyangyu Dongfang on the shoulder, and Kaiyangyu Dongfang immediately stepped off to the side as he said in a respectful manner, "I'll be counting on you, big brother." The man nodded in response before casting his gaze toward Tang Wulin. The man bore a very similar appearance to Kaiyangyu Dongfang, and he appeared to be slightly younger than Kaiyangyu Dongfang, yet Kaiyangyu Dongfang was referring to him as big brother, and that was a clear indication of his status in the Spirit Pagoda. His partner was an elegant woman who wore a faint smile, and she appeared to be in her 30s. She was holding hands with the man, and they seemed to be very intimate with one another. The two of them exchanged a glance before rising straight up into the air, and neither of them released their martial soul from the get-go. Two people also rose up from the Shrek Academy camp, and Tang Wulin's partner was none other than Holy Spirit Douluo Yali. Yali was also very beautiful and youthful in appearance, and if one didn't know any better, they could be forgiven for thinking that these two were a pair of lovers as well. "That's Kaiyangyu Kingfeng. I didn't think that he would represent the Spirit Pagoda," Yali said in a low voice. "Kaiyangyu Kingfeng?" Tang Wulin turned toward Yali with a perplexed expression to find that there was a hint of concern in her eyes. Yali explained, "He's Kaiyangyu Dongfang's blood brother, but in contrast with Kaiyangyu Dongfang, who grew up in the Spirit Pagoda, he was very rebellious in his youth, and his martial soul wasn't the coiling dragon staff, so he wasn't held in as high a regard in the Kaiyangyu family." Chapter 1622. In his formative years, the cultivation aptitude he displayed was quite ordinary. Back when he was 12, Kaiyangyu Dongfang had already outstripped his cultivation rank at just 9 years of age. As a result, he became even more looked down on, and was even bullied to a certain extent. He and Kaiyangyu Dongfang had different mothers, and his mother had passed away not long after his birth, so his life in the Kaiyangyu family was quite difficult. At 14 years of age, he asked for a sum of money from the Kaiyangyu family with the alibi of seeking an education, and he left for 20 years. During those years, Kaiyangyu Dongfang progressed rapidly with the support of the entire Kaiyangyu family, and at just 30 years of age, he was already a titled Douluo. However, it was right at this point that Kaiyangyu Kingfeng suddenly returned, and the first thing he did following his return was challenge Kaiyangyu Dongfang. As they were speaking, Yali and Tang Wulin had already risen to the same altitude as Kaiyangyu Kingfeng and his wife. "I'm assuming Kaiyangyu Kingfeng won?" Tang Wulin asked as he appraised his opponents. Yali nodded in response. Apparently, Kaiyangyu Dongfang was utterly crushed. After defeating Kaiyangyu Dongfang, he declared that it wasn't that he couldn't compete with Kaiyangyu Dongfang. He simply didn't want to. After that, he left the Kaiyangyu family once again and didn't take on any official role in the Spirit Pagoda. "I didn't think that he would show up here. He was already able to crush Kaiyangyu Dongfang several decades ago. I'm sure he's even more powerful now." Tang Wulin asked with a rather perplexed expression. "Why haven't I ever heard of him? Has he not traveled the continent in the past?" "He has, but..." Yoli's voice trailed off here as Taiyangyu Kingfeng made an inviting hand gesture toward them, and said, "Let's begin." He took a step forward as he spoke, releasing a total of 9 soul rings, comprised of 6 blacks and 3 reds. Meanwhile, his wife sat down in midair with a faint smile, and a miniature guchang appeared on her lap. The guchang was completely snowy white in color, and was giving off a faint frosty mist. She also possessed 9 soul rings, and her soul ring configuration wasn't as elite as that of Taiyangyu Kingfeng, but her final soul ring was also red. Thus, they were a pair of titled Douluos who both possessed 100,000-year-old soul rings, and there was a very good chance that Taiyangyu Kingfeng was a limit Douluo. This was clearly not going to be an easy match for Shrek Academy. "That's Frost Symphony Douluo," she assembled. Yali exclaimed. Tang Wulin vaulted slightly upon hearing this. He had heard this name before, but couldn't quite match the face to the name. There were countless types of martial souls in the Soul Master world, but they could be split up into several broad categories. For example, there were beast martial souls and tool martial souls. In terms of battle styles, they could be split up into the assault system, control system, agility attack system, defense system, food system, etc. Among those categories was one known as soundwave type martial souls. This was an often overlooked category as Soul Masters who possessed this type of martial soul were quite rare. Tang Wulin had heard of this Frost Symphony Douluo as she was listed as the current number one soundwave type Soul Master in Shrek Academy's records. Her Frosty Symphony Guchang was a truly formidable martial soul, and her reputation had been forged as far back as several decades ago. As such, she had to at least be a hyper Douluo. She had kept a very low profile for the past few decades, and it was quite a surprise to see her representing the spirit pagoda here. It seems that the spirit pagoda had more depth than previously imagined. She as Angle and Kaiyangyu Kingfeng were definitely an extremely fearsome pair. Kaiyangyu Kingfeng raised a hand high up into the air, and a long weapon appeared in his grasp amid a flash of black light. This was a massive ancient halberd that was roughly comparable to Tang Wuling's trident in size, except the arrangement of the blades on the two weapons were quite different. "That's Kaiyangyu Kingfeng's purgatory halberd. His Douluo title is also purgatory," Yali quickly explained. Tang Wuling nodded in response, and all of a sudden, his surroundings seemed to have been plunged into complete darkness. This wasn't darkness on a visual level. Instead, he felt as if his mind had gone completely dark. In the next instant, an extremely heavy aura descended upon him as Kaiyangyu Kingfeng unleashed the first attack. This was his first soul skill, Dark Knight Assassination. Tang Wuling's senses were temporarily blinded, and the fact that his opponent was able to infuse his spiritual power into his soul skill to affect Tang Wuling indicated that he was definitely also at the mental manifestation level. As expected, this Kaiyangyu Kingfeng really was a limit Douluo. A crisp clang rang out, and a burst of light emerged in the darkness, illuminating everything in the surrounding area. Tang Wulin was hovering in midair in a stable manner, keeping the purgatory halberd at bay with his shimmering golden dragon spear. A hint of surprise appeared in Kaiyangyu Kingfeng's eyes upon seeing this, and all of a sudden, scintillating light erupted from his purgatory halberd as he slashed it through the air to unleash a purplish black blade projection. This was his second soul skill, Nether Slash. The slash appeared to be very simple and nonchalant, but it struck Tang Wulin with a sense of extreme peril. He immediately retreated as he released his golden dragon body, upon which a layer of golden scales appeared all over his skin, and he also unleashed his golden dragon vibrational explosion to oppose the Nether Slash. At the same time, he thrust his golden dragon spear forward, sending countless golden spear projections hurtling directly toward Kaiyangyu Kingfeng. Fury of the masses. Tang Wulin had once held the title of Spear God, and his mastery of the spear had reached an exceptional level. Currently, his fury of the masses was completely subdued and gave off no threatening aura at all, as if it were one with heaven and earth. Becoming one with nature was a state that was extremely valuable to all soul masters, yet Tang Wulin had achieved this a long time ago. As the one who was blessed by the plane, it was far easier for him to enter this state than others. Right at this moment, a clear ringing sound rang out, and Tang Wulin felt as if a bucket of icy water had been poured over his head, instantly causing him to become quite sluggish. At the same time, his fury of the masses had lost its direction, and right at this moment, the purplish black purgatory halberd instantly reached his chest. Tang Wulin didn't panic in the slightest as he gripped onto his golden dragon spear with both hands to oppose the oncoming halberd, and at the same time, all of his golden scales took on a mirror-like appearance. This was his second golden dragon king soul skill, golden dragon tyrant body. Clang. Tang Wulin was forced backward, while the purgatory halberd was repelled by the golden dragon spear. However, in the instant that the two weapons had come into contact with one another, Tang Wulin had been struck by an indescribably torturous feeling, as if his soul had been about to escape out of his body. Only after being struck by Kaiyangyu Kingfeng's Nether Slash did Tang Wulin come to understand just how fearsome it was. Even though he could still control his own body, he felt as if he had lost control of his own soul, and it was hovering beside his body. Chapter 1623. This was an attack that struck on both the physical and mental level, and it was not to be faced head on. If he were to be struck by another Nether Slash, his exposed soul would be damaged, and that could result in catastrophic consequences. Kaiyangyu Kingfeng was also quite surprised by Tang Wulin's strength. Even though his Nether Slash was only his second soul skill, it was his core soul skill, just like Lanmuzi's Spring Sun and White Snow. Once he forced his opponent's soul out of their body, all of his subsequent attacks would be far more damaging to his opponent. At the same time, his Nether Slash was a ferocious attack that condensed all of his strength and soul power. Countless opponents had been unable to withstand even a single Nether Slash in his past battles. Yet not only had Tang Wulin managed to withstand it, he had managed to use his golden dragon spear to send the purgatory halberd flying when the former was far thinner than the latter. Even with his limit Douluo level powers, he hadn't been able to gain even the slightest upper hand in that clash. Even though Kaiyangyu Kingfeng wasn't a quasi god yet, he was still a veteran demigod, and with the special nature of his purgatory halberd that targeted the opponent's soul, even Kaiyangyu Dongfang couldn't match him in battle. However, his demigod level soul power had been unable to crush Tang Wulin, and that was sufficient testament to just how immense Tang Wulin's pure strength was. Kaiyangyu Kingfeng couldn't help but be struck by a sense of intrigue. As expected, this outrageously young Tang sect master and Sea God's pavilion master really was quite special. Right at this moment, the golden dragon spear was thrust forward again, and it was still fury of the masses that was unleashed, but the attack was also accompanied by a thunderous dragon's roar. A massive golden dragon head erupted out of Tang Wulin's body, and the deafening dragon's roar surged throughout heaven and earth, forcibly drowning out the sound of the Frost Symphony Guchang. Even with his purgatory halberd held horizontally before him, Kaiyangyu Kingfeng was still struck by a burst of enormous force, and he was stunned by how drastically Tang Wulin's strength had increased. Unbeknownst to him, he was facing Tang Wulin's golden dragon tyrant body, which meant that he was essentially having to withstand both Tang Wulin's attack and his own attack. Most of the journalists and spectators down below weren't aware of who Kaiyangyu Kingfeng was, but the media had all the answers. Some television stations had already begun an exhaustive search, and Kaiyangyu Kingfeng and his origins were quickly being introduced. He was the blood brother of the current spirit pagoda chairman, and was very likely to be a limit Douluo as well. In addition to Kaiyangyu Dieting, who had already reached the quasi-god level, the Kaiyangyu family had already displayed 3 limit Douluo, and it was no wonder that the family was the dominant force in the spirit pagoda. On top of that, there was Heavenly Phoenix Douluo Leng Yaoshu, which amounted to 4 limit Douluo in total in the spirit pagoda. This was already an astonishing lineup, and no one knew whether the spirit pagoda had even more limit Douluo among its ranks. At the very least, it was almost a foregone conclusion that Silver Dragon Princess Yuyuno was going to become a limit Douluo in the future. Just as Tang Wulin had been very confident in Araheng and Simajin Kai, Kaiyangyu Dongfang was extremely confident in this pair. Provoking Shrek Academy had been part of his plan from the very beginning, and he was going to take advantage of this opportunity to display the true power of the spirit pagoda to everyone. Shrek Academy had officially reemerged during the Joust for a Spouse event, and some of the powers in the military, including the Battle God Hole, had begun to switch their allegiance. This was partially due to the sway of Shrek Academy, but also because the spirit pagoda was simply too powerful. An almighty organization was something that none of the major powers in the Federation wanted to see. With its artificial black soul spirits and myriad beast plane, the spirit pagoda had been able to earn astronomical profits in a very short time, and they possessed an extremely high level of influence in the federal parliament. It was exactly because of this that all of the other major powers had become very wary of the spirit pagoda, and they were beginning to become more reserved in their support toward the spirit pagoda. After an internal meeting in the spirit pagoda, a decision was made. There would be no way to win back the favor of these major powers through appeasement or bribery, as none of that changed the fact that the spirit pagoda was constantly constantly becoming more and more powerful. As such, they decided to go with the flow and make all other powers even wearier of the spirit pagoda. Weariness to a certain degree would turn into fear, and fear was something that the spirit pagoda could use to further exert its control. Currently, the spirit pagoda was expanding at a rapid rate. The myriad beast plane and artificial black soul spirits had allowed them to recruit a massive number of powerful soul masters, and the spirit pagoda was more powerful than it had ever been. As this trend continued, a fundamental change was inevitable. As such, not only were they trying to ruin Shrek Academy's enrollment here, they were also flexing their muscles to intimidate all those who had begun to deviate away from the spirit pagoda. Kaiyangyu Daiding had invited Kaiyangyu King Feng to participate in this clash in person, as he was the only one in the entire spirit pagoda that had any sway over this eldest son of his. Kaiyangyu King Feng was currently one of the spirit pagoda's 36 core members of the spirit pagoda. The chairman and vice chairman were both core members, but even spirit envoys weren't considered to be core members of the spirit pagoda, with the exception of Guyuna, who was being heavily endorsed to become a new core member. Guyuna had proven herself through her display of power, while Kaiyangyu Sanjing hadn't even made it into the final 10 of the Joust for a Spouse event. He would only have a chance of becoming a core member of the spirit pagoda if Spirit Academy could flourish with him at the helm. It was exactly due to Kaiyangyu Dongfang's confidence in his brother that he was paying extra attention to Kaiyangyu King Feng's clash against Tang Wulin. Just as he had feared, Tang Wulin was developing far too quickly. To his astonishment, Tang Wulin was able to directly withstand Kaiyangyu King Feng's purgatory halberd with his strength alone. He had once been defeated by Kaiyangyu King Feng, so he was well aware of just how heavy the purgatory halberd was. He was absolutely certain that Tang Wulin had made a major breakthrough to the Hyper Douluo level. He was already a Hyper Douluo in his 20s. Was this the true power of Shrek Academy? Tang Wulin's rapid rate of progression was truly inexplicable to him. Furthermore, he had proven to everyone that he was a divine blacksmith through the new pieces of four-word battle armor that had appeared in the Shrek Academy camp. There was no way that Zhenhua would have been able to create so many pieces of four-word battle armor in his current condition. This young man was truly blessed by the heavens, and it was imperative for him to be cut down before he could fully develop. In Tang Wulin, Kaiyangyu Dongfang could clearly see a shadow of the past Yan Ming. He could clearly recall the first time that he had seen Yan Ming. That was during the battle between Yan Ming and his father. At the time, their cultivation ranks were quite comparable, but Kaiyangyu Daiding was dominated from start to finish. That had been a very traumatic experience for Kaiyangyu Daiding, and it took him 30 years longer than anticipated to reach the quasi-god level. Chapter 1624. Yan Ming had cast a massive shadow over the entire Spirit Pagoda, and it was exactly because of this that the Spirit Pagoda had been forced to destroy Shrek Academy at all costs. He definitely couldn't allow Tang Wulin to become the next Yan Ming. A hint of killing intent surfaced in Kaiyangyu Dongfang's eyes, and he was already considering how he was going to target Tang Wulin after crushing Shrek Academy. Tang Wulin's greatest asset wasn't his power. Instead, it was his heavenly refinement ability. At this rate, all of the most powerful beings of Shrek Academy would most likely attain full suits of four-word battle armor in no more than 10 years. Divine blacksmith Zhenhua was already too old to produce large quantities of divine grade metals, so Tang Wulin was definitely going to monopolize that market in the future. Unlike Zhenhua, he wasn't the chairman of the Blacksmith Association, so he wasn't required to offer his services to other powers. Just like how the Spirit Pagoda was planning to refuse to provide soul spirits to the students and teachers of Shrek Academy, Tang Wulin would refuse to provide the Spirit Pagoda with divine grade metals. Seeing as there was no way for him to win over Tang Wulin, he had to destroy this threat as quickly as possible. Tang Wulin was naturally unaware of what Kaiyangyu Dongfang was thinking. Even if he were, he wouldn't be fearful in the slightest anyway. He was no longer the fragile little hatching who could perish at any moment. He was already a majestic eagle soaring through the heavens, and it was not going to be easy to target him. Kaiyangyu King Feng retreated slightly, and countless projections erupted out of his purgatory halberd to nullify the fury of the masses. Right at this moment, a gentle guchang tune rang out again. Tang Wulin's golden dragon roar could only last a short time, but the guchang could be played continuously. The notes being played by the guchang were like a series of weapons that were imbued with chilling intent, surging toward Tang Wulin from all sides to affect his mind and actions. Even though these weren't actual attacks, they were severely debilitating him. Strangely enough, Yali was standing still in the spot, displaying no intention to involve herself in this match. As a result, this had become a one-on-two battle. A hint of fury flashed through Kaiyangyu King Feng's eyes as he raised his purgatory halberd high up into the air. He had naturally also noticed that Yali hadn't been doing anything this entire time. Could it be that she was planning to let this Hyper Douluo brat take on both him and his wife? A burst of purplish black light erupted from the purgatory halberd, illuminating Kaiyangyu King Feng's entire body, and another nether slash was unleashed. But this one was thrice the size of the previous one. Tang Wulin had already dragged his soul back into his own body after forcing back his opponent with his fury of the masses, but he definitely didn't want to be struck by another nether slash. Furthermore, he could sense that the Frost Infinity Guchang was very potent against both his mind and his soul, so if his soul were to leave his body again, there was a good chance that it would be immediately frozen by the Guchang. Thus, he drifted backward and prepared to unleash his golden dragon vibrational explosion again to escape the opponent's attack. But right at this moment, the tune being played by the Guchang suddenly changed. The sky became completely clear, and Tang Wulin was suddenly struck by the feeling that the air that was supporting his weight had abruptly vanished, causing him to plummet out of the sky. This was Shia Hengong's fourth soul skill, vacuum draw. The area around Tang Wulin had been instantly transformed into a vacuum, so how was he supposed to stabilize his own body in midair? This sudden turn of events completely foiled Tang Wulin's attempt to retreat, and as the son of nature, he was able to immediately draw an air to stabilize himself, but it was too late for him to evade the oncoming nether slash. This combination had been executed by Kaiyangyu King Feng and Shia Hengong on countless occasions, and the timing was absolutely perfect, affording Tang Wulin no chance to evade. This nether slash had been enhanced by Kaiyangyu King Feng's third soul skill, purgatory rage, and as a result, it was far more powerful than the previous one. Right at this moment, the air suddenly warped slightly, and time seemed to have paused for an instant before everything was reversed back to a second ago. The vacuum draw was yet to be unleashed, while Kaiyangyu King Feng had just released his purgatory rage, but still hadn't unleashed his nether slash yet. Another thunderous golden dragon roar rang out, stopping Kaiyangyu King Feng cold in his tracks, and Shia Hengong's vacuum draw was also delayed for a split second. Taking advantage of this split second of respite, Tang Wulin flapped his golden dragon wings to fly back in retreat. Through the use of his spiritual domain, he had escaped that dire situation, but there were still chills running down his spine. As expected, limit Douluos were extremely formidable. In the next instant, the nether slash passed through the spot where he had been just a moment ago, and the vacuum draw also erupted in the same area, but it didn't manage to encompass him on this occasion. Was that time reversal? Interesting. Kaiyangyu King Feng mused with an intrigued expression. He had always been an extremely competitive person ever since he was just a child. Everyone knew that he had been looked down on in the Kaiyangyu family, but no one was aware of how introverted his personality had been. Kaiyangyu Daiding had actually treated him quite well, seeing as Kaiyangyu King Feng was his eldest son, and even though he hadn't inherited the coiling dragon staff martial soul, the purgatory halberd he had inherited from his mother was still quite a powerful martial soul. However, Kaiyangyu King Feng didn't accept his father's love as he resented his father for having so many lovers. He then went on to leave the family due to Kaiyangyu Dongfang's brilliance, and back when they were children, his attitude really was far inferior to Kaiyangyu Dongfang's. It was exactly due to his competitive nature that he was unable to bear the fact that his brother was better than him, thereby leading to his decision to leave the family. It wasn't that he didn't care about status and his position in the family. Instead, he cared too much. Only after he met his current wife, Shia Hengong, did his personality change, and became a lot more mellow compared to his past competitive self. It was also because of Shia Hengong coming into his life that he was able to become a limit Douluo. As such, he was extremely caring and loving toward his wife. After progressing to the limit Douluo level, Kaiyangyu King Feng's competitive nature had become far more restrained. However, old habits were always hard to die, and he couldn't help but compare himself with Tang Wulin at the same age. As a result, he discovered that he simply couldn't compare with this young man. Back when he was Tang Wulin's age, he hadn't even reached the title Douluo level yet. He couldn't even remember if he had been a soul Douluo at that point. How could this young man be this outrageously gifted? No matter how hard he worked, there was no way he would be able to achieve all this without supreme aptitude. He slowly pointed his purgatory halberd toward Tang Wulin and said, "Let's continue." Tang Wulin was appraising Kaiyangyu King Feng with a very serious expression. Even though he was no longer his former self, his opponent was also far more powerful than the Holy Dragon Douluo. He had faced quite a few limit Douluo up to this point, and all of them had their own unique powers and abilities, but one thing they shared was that they were all extremely powerful. The one that had exerted the most pressure upon him was Infernal King Douluo Harrisa. Back when he had faced Harrisa, he had been struck by a sense of complete powerlessness. Of course, that was only to be expected as he wasn't even a titled Douluo at the time. Now, he was already a hyper Douluo, and he wanted to see just how much of a disparity there still was between himself and a limit Douluo. Yali wasn't watching from the sidelines because she wanted to test Tangwaleen. It was Tangwaleen himself who had proposed that he wanted to stimulate his own latent potential by facing a limit Douluo. Throughout his entire cultivation journey, almost all of his major breakthroughs had arrived after extreme pressure had been exerted upon him. During these past few months, Tangwaleen had constantly been cultivating while practicing heavenly refinement, and he had consolidated the powers he had gained during his past few breakthroughs, as well as accumulated more power day by day. Even he could clearly sense that he had made a fundamental improvement, and this was a wonderful feeling, which was why he was so keen to face a truly powerful being following this latest breakthrough. Tangwaleen slowly raised his golden dragon spear, then stepped forward and charged directly toward Kyangyu Kingfang. Chapter 1625. His wings flapped in short, sharp motions, elevating his speed to the very max, and he instantly reached Kyangyu Kingfang like a golden shooting star. A cold smile appeared on Kyangyu Kingfang's face as he unleashed his nether slash again, and his timing was perfect, ensuring that Tangwaleen would inevitably fall into the scope of the attack as long as he didn't decelerate. If he were to slow down to evade the attack, then his momentum would be snapped, thereby allowing Kyangyu Kingfang to seize the initiative. Xia Sangun continued to play Oguchang, yet on this occasion, a series of silent sound waves were being released, causing the air to shimmer and warp, thereby making it impossible to determine which directions the sound waves were traveling toward. However, it was at this moment that Tangwaleen's superb bodily control really shone through. His immensely powerful physical constitution didn't just grant him incredible strength and speed, but also allowed him to change directions and speeds in a way that almost defied physics. All of a sudden, time abruptly accelerated, causing the nether slash to speed up so that by the time the halberd slashed through the air, Tangwaleen still hadn't arrived yet. Kyangyu Kingfang was rather alarmed by this, and he reflexively dodged to the side at an incredible speed. As soon as he vacated his original spot, the Frost Symphony Invisible Swords Xia Sangun had unleashed immediately arrived, further putting their exemplary teamwork on display. However, Tangwaleen's body suddenly drew to an abrupt halt in a drastic deceleration that shouldn't have been physically possible. Immediately thereafter, he arched back, and it was as if his entire body had transformed into a bow, while the golden dragon spear in his right hand was the figurative arrow on the bowstring. Kyangyu Kingfang's heart jolted upon seeing this, and he reflexively swept his purgatory halberd through the air, releasing a total of 18 purplish black halos that proliferated outward around his body. This was his fourth soul skill, Purgatory Roar. It was the perfect fusion of attack and defense. However, Tangwaleen still held his golden dragon spear through the air without any hesitation, and Kyangyu Kingfang's expression immediately changed drastically as he could sense that the attack was no longer locked onto him. In the next instant, the golden dragon spear flashed past him like a bolt of golden lightning. Tangwaleen only had two opponents, and the target wasn't Kyangyu Kingfang, so it was quite obvious exactly whom he was targeting. In the blink of an eye, Tangwaleen had used his time reversal domain to accelerate time, then drew to an abrupt halt before hailing his golden dragon spear through the air in a smooth, almost choreographed sequence. Kyangyu Kingfang would have countless ways to withstand Tangwaleen's attack, and he was very confident in his own wife's abilities, but he was also quite wary of Tangwaleen's powers, and his heart immediately sank as Tangwaleen's golden dragon spear hurtled directly toward Xia Sangun. The Frost Symphony Invisible Swords also reached Tangwaleen at almost the exact same moment. In response, Tangwaleen unleashed his dragon's repulse, followed immediately by his golden dragon vibrational explosion. A thunderous explosion erupted within a radius of 5 meters, and the Frost Symphony Invisible Swords exploded into a vast expanse of ice shards, none of which were able to come into contact with Tangwaleen. In the instant that Tangwaleen had held his golden dragon spear, Xia Sangun was immediately struck by a sharp pain in her chest, and in that instant, she felt as if her blood had congealed. Could she dodge? It was already too late. The golden dragon spear was simply far too fast. This was Tangwaleen's all or nothing. However, Xia Sangun's title as the number one soundwave type soul master wasn't just an empty accolade. Her Frost Symphony Guchang began to emit a faint buzzing sound, and a suit of battle armor with snowflake patterns all over its surface quickly appeared over her entire body. Even though it was only a suit of three-way battle armor, it was extremely dazzling to behold. Immediately thereafter, Xia Sangun took the only defensive measure that she had time to adopt. She raised her Frost Symphony Guchang in front of herself as a shield. In the next instant, the golden dragon spear arrived. The strings of Frost Symphony Guchang were facing Xia Sangun, and she was holding onto the top of the Guchang with one hand as she quickly stroked the top three strings with her other hand. A sharp note rang out, and the Guchang instantly released 9 layers of light barriers, each of which resembled a layer of frost with that same note echoing incessantly within them. This was her Frost Symphony 9 barriers. Xia Sangun had faced countless powerful opponents throughout her life, and she certainly hadn't reached her current soul power rank of 97 through sheer luck. Her Frost Symphony Guchang possessed extremely powerful prowess, both in offense and defense, and as soon as she was struck by a sense of peril, she immediately released her battle armor, as well as these Frost Symphony 9 barriers to form the ultimate defense. She was confident that her husband wouldn't allow Tangwaleen to unleash a second attack, and having lost his weapon, Tangwaleen was definitely going to be far less difficult to deal with. Thus, the golden dragon spear reached Xia Sangun, giving off a peerlessly sharp aura, and her Frost Symphony 9 barriers were almost instantly shattered. The golden dragon spear then struck the underside of the Frost Symphony Guchang, upon which Xia Sangun gave a muffled groan as she was quickly forced backward by the impact. At the same time, that peerlessly sharp aura surged toward her body in a frenzy. What a powerful attack. This attack is definitely at the limit Douluo level. It's a good thing. Her thoughts were abruptly cut off here as a layer of rainbow light erupted from the dazzling golden spear. This was not good. A sense of foreboding had only just appeared in her heart when the golden dragon spear pierced through the Frost Symphony Guchang before impaling the right side of her chest. There was no pain, but in that instant, Xia Sangun felt all of her power begin to melt away like ice and snow. Even with her rank 97 soul power, she was unable to control her own body and began to plummet out of the sky. Sangun. Kyangyu Kingfang was just planning to attack Tangwaleen, but he was stunned to see that Tangwaleen's attack was powerful enough to pierce through Xia Sangun's defenses. In the instant that Xia Sangun's chest had been impaled, he felt like his own chest had been run through as well. The purgatory roar around him erupted toward Tangwaleen in a mad frenzy, while he instantly turned around and flew over to Xia Sangun before catching her. Xia Sangun's face was already completely devoid of color, and her life force was receding at an alarming rate. There was something off about this spear. As a limit Douluo, Kyangyu Kingfang's judgment and intuition were both exceptional, and he immediately grabbed onto the golden dragon spear, upon which his own life force also began to funnel into the spear in a frenzy. Chapter 1626. However, he was already mentally prepared, and he immediately wrenched his hand away from the golden dragon spear before pressing against Xia Sangun's chest, injecting his soul power into her body to forcibly prevent the golden dragon spear from continuing to devour her life energy. Right at this moment, a gentle voice rang out, "Hand her over to me." Kyangyu Kingfang was just about to flare with rage, but the fury in his eyes faded at the sight of the person who had arrived beside him, only to be replaced by a hint of indignation. "We can see, please save my wife." The person who had approached him was none other than Holy Spirit Douluo Yali. In contrast with her resentment toward Kyangyu Dongfang, Yali had a far better first impression of Kyangyu Kingfang. At the very least, this was a man who deeply loved his wife, and she couldn't help but think of Yanming. "Willing," Yali called out, and the golden dragon spear that had impaled Xia Sangun's chest vanished amid a flash of golden light. Yali then pressed her right hand against Xia Sangun's chest, injecting bursts of gentle white light into her body to nourish and stabilize her receding life energy. As she treated Xia Sangun, everyone from both camps slowly descended onto the ground. Kyangyu Kingfang immediately turned toward Tangwaleen with burning fury in his eyes. If it weren't for the fact that he was relying on Yali to treat Xia Sangun, he would have most likely already pounced toward Tangwaleen. Tangwaleen descended expressionlessly onto the ground, and in the eyes of all of the parents and students in the distance, he was like a god entity. That final spear strike unleashed by Tangwaleen had truly stunned everyone, and no one could predict that this 2-on-2 match would conclude under these circumstances. Kyangyu Kingfang had made a grave error by underestimating Tangwaleen's explosive power and evading to expose his wife to Tangwaleen's line of attack. Not only was the golden dragon spear imbued with Tangwaleen's spear intent and spear soul, it had also been infused with the power of elemental tribulations. Having undergone so much heavenly refinement, Tangwaleen had developed an extremely in-depth understanding of elemental tribulations. His understanding of planar laws had also reached a whole new level, and even among limit Douluo, there were very few people who could compare with him when it came to understanding of elemental laws. From the very beginning, Tang Wulin had planned for that final spear strike to be the decisive blow. He knew that it would be quite difficult to defeat Kaiyang Yikingfeng, but he was confident that Chia's Hengong was no match for him. As such, he had injected all of his power into that attack and directed the attack toward the weakest link. The instant that he had released his golden dragon spear was when he had been the most vulnerable, and Kaiyang Yikingfeng would have definitely been able to suppress Tang Wulin had he chosen to attack then. However, Tang Wulin was confident that Kaiyang Yikingfeng's attention would be diverted away, and that he would at least make sure that his wife would be fine before he attacked Tang Wulin. This was already enough time for Tang Wulin to recover. Thus, Shrek Academy secured victory in the second 2-on-2 match, and the score now stood at 6-5. All right, she'll be fine now. Get her to eat some foods that'll replenish her lost life energy, and she'll be fully recovered with some rest, Yali said as she lifted her hand from Chia's Hengong's chest. Kaiyang Yikingfeng's aura was still rather unstable, but he nodded in response. Thank you. Thus, Yali returned to the Shrek Academy camp. This match was a victory for Shrek Academy both on a practical basis, as well as on a moral basis, as Tang Wulin had essentially defeated his two opponents on his own. Even though he had chosen to attack the weakest link in the form of Chia's Hengong, Chia's Hengong had been attacking him throughout the entire battle as well. The match had concluded before either side had unleashed their full power, but this was a reflection of Tang Wulin's understanding of the entire battlefield, as well as his ability to grasp opportunities. After witnessing that final spear strike, everyone truly realized just how fearsome his explosive power was. His golden dragon spear was like an unstoppable force of nature. Chia's Hengong had been unable to stop the golden dragon spear from devouring her life energy as her martial soul had been severely damaged, and in that weakened state, she was in no shape to pose any resistance. Not only had Tang Wulin essentially won this battle on a 1-on-2 basis, Shrek Academy's generosity had also been put on full display through Yali's gesture in healing Chia's Hengong. Kaiyang Dongfang had already arrived beside Kaiyang Yikingfeng, but the latter was too busy attending to his wife to pay any heed to him. Kaiyang Dongfang heaved a faint internal sigh. If his brother hadn't underestimated Tang Wulin, the outcome of the match may have been different. He had already decided that he couldn't regard Tang Wulin as a junior anymore. He had to view him as an equal and give him sufficient attention. This thought startled even himself as it appeared in his mind. Since when was it that Tang Wulin had to be regarded as equivalent to a limit Douluo? At this point in the clash, Kaiyang Dongfang was already becoming rather agitated. When he had proposed this bet, he had thought that they would be able to crush Shrek Academy with ease, and that the match would already be over at this point. As the matches commenced, he became even more confident in his own assessment of the situation. But somehow, Shrek Academy was always able to claw their way back just when he thought that the spirit pagoda had gained an absolute advantage. Chairman Kaiyang Yu. Tang Wulin turned to Kaiyang Dongfang with a faint smile. Kaiyang Dongfang asked, "What is it, Sex Master Tang?" Tang Wulin replied, "The score is currently 6-5. You have the upper hand, but the final 2-on-2 battle holds no importance anymore. So let's not delay our Shrek Academy's enrollment day any longer. Let's decide the outcome of this clash with the final 7-on-7 battle." Kaiyang Dongfang took a meaningful glance at Tang Wulin. Why was it that this young man was looking so confident? It didn't make any sense. Was he merely bluffing? Indeed, the final 2-on-2 battle was inconsequential, and Shrek Academy could simply concede the match if they wanted to. After all, even if Shrek Academy were to win the final 2-on-2 match, they would still lose overall if they lost the 7-on-7 match. With that in mind, Kaiyang Dongfang nodded in response. "All right, then let's decide this with the final 7-on-7 match," Tang Wulin proposed. "Then how about we begin after a 5-minute break?" "Sure," Kaiyang Dongfang agreed. Neither Tang Wulin nor Kaiyang Yikingfeng had exerted themselves much during the previous match, so there was no point in not allowing Tang Wulin to rest. Thus, both sides returned to their respective camps to prepare for the decisive match. Teamwork was going to be imperative in the 7-on-7 match, and it was the best display of each side's overall power. All of the journalists on the scene were extremely excited. A 7-on-7 match between Shrek Academy and the Spirit Pagoda was definitely going to be a 7-on-7 clash of the highest caliber in the current Soul Master world. Chapter 1627. In contrast with this final match, all of the previous matches were essentially no more than appetizers. The outcome of this clash was undoubtedly going to decide who would gain the upper hand in enrollment. 5 minutes quickly passed by, and Kaiyang Dongfang strode forward, followed closely by 6 other people. The one directly beside him was none other than Kaiyang Yikingfeng, who was still very frustrated due to the loss in the last match. Kaiyang Yikingfeng was glaring at Tang Wulin with flames of wrath burning in his eyes. This was the first time that Chia's Hengong had been injured so severely since their marriage. How could he not be enraged? On the other side of Kaiyang Dongfang stood Lang Yaoshu, presenting a lineup of 3 limit Douluo. Behind them was the elderly man with the brain martial soul who defeated Tang Yimeng. His exact cultivation rank was still yet to be determined, but it was no exaggeration to say that he possessed the greatest spiritual power of any soul master in the world. All of a sudden, a person emerged from the crowd, and as soon as he did so, the pressure on Shrek Academy was instantly raised significantly. The new arrival was none other than the former chairman of the Spirit Pagoda, the father of Kaiyang Dongfang, and Kaiyang Yikingfeng, Kaiyang Dongfang. This already made 4 limit Douluo in total in addition to an ultra-powerful spiritual system soul master. The final 2 spots of the 7 representatives for the Spirit Pagoda were occupied by the Bi-Sisters. Their soul fusion skill possessed immense explosive power, and these 7 were equivalent in power to 6 limit Douluo. With such a formidable lineup, how could Kaiyang Dongfang not be confident? From the Shrek Academy camp, the first to emerge was naturally none other than Tang Wulin. He was followed by 2 women, one of whom was Yali, while the other was a stunning beauty that looked to be similar to Yali in age, but was quite unfamiliar. A surprised look appeared on Kaiyang Dongfang's face. "Long Yayu. You became young again?" No wonder it had seemed that Long Yeyu had been absent. They had simply failed to recognize her until now. Kaiyang Dongfang had seen Long Yeyu in her younger days, and now that she had emerged alongside Tang Wulin, he was able to immediately identify her. Long Yeyu smiled and said, "You think everyone wants to be an old geezer like you?" Of course, there was no way that Long Yeyu would miss such an important moment. Aside from Long Yeyu and Yali, there were 2 unfamiliar faces among the 4 other people accompanying Tang Wulin, one of whom was an elderly man, while the other was a middle-aged man. Both of them possessed powerful auras, clearly indicating that they were no slouches. One of the remaining 2 representatives for Shrek Academy was none other than Xu Xiaolan of Shrek 7 Monsters, while the other was an imposing yet hideous man. Not only were those from the Spirit Pagoda unable to recognize him, even in Shrek Academy, Tang Wulin was the only one who was aware of this man's identity. Kaiyang Dongfang had thought that Lan Muzi would definitely feature for Shrek Academy in the final 7-on-7 battle, but Lan Muzi and Tang Yimeng were both absent, and that was quite a surprise to him. What was even more disconcerting was that he couldn't recognize 3 of Shrek Academy's 7 representatives. This was definitely not a good thing, and he was immediately struck by a sense of foreboding. "Would you like to introduce these new faces to us, Sex Master Tang?" Kaiyang Dongfang asked in a calm manner. Tang Wulin replied with a smile, "These are newly appointed teachers for our Shrek Academy, so it's no surprise that you don't recognize them. Rest assured, Chairman Kaiyang, they're all from our academy." Kaiyang Dongfang nodded in response. "All right, I'll take your word for it." In reality, he was very relieved that the amorous Douluo and heartless Douluo were absent. His greatest concern was that Tang Wulin would make a borderline violation of the rules by getting those 2 to represent Shrek Academy. Not only were Cao Dajia and Zhang Xin both limit Douluo, they possessed an extremely fearsome soul fusion skill, and even Yang Ming had once said that it would be very difficult for him to defeat this pair's soul fusion skill. This soul fusion skill had been rated as the current most powerful soul fusion skill on the entire Douluo continent, and if they were to temporarily join Shrek Academy, then withdraw following the clash, there really wasn't anything that the Spirit Pagoda could say. With those 2 present, the Spirit Pagoda's chances of securing victory would be severely lowered. Thankfully, Shrek Academy hadn't made the shameless move of borrowing the Tang Sex power. These 3 new faces were very unfamiliar, but surely they couldn't be more powerful than Zhang Xin and Cao Dajia. With that in mind, Kaiyang Dongfang's confidence was bolstered once again. They had the equivalent of 6 limit Douluo on their side. There was no way Shrek Academy could match such a formidable lineup. "Please enlighten me, Sex Master Tang." "Likewise, Chairman Kaiyang." Thus, the 14 combatants rose up into the air in unison. Right at this moment, a burst of buzzing rang out in the distance, heralding the arrival of soul planes that were going to capture footage of this generational clash for the media. The cameras on these planes were designed for long distance use, so the footage was going to be a lot clearer than before. "Everyone, no matter where you are right now, drop everything and get to your nearest television, because a once in a generation clash is about to take place. This is going to be a 7-on-7 match between Shrek Academy and the Spirit Pagoda, and as a journalist, my blood is boiling in my veins. Our planes are going to be shooting footage from 2 kilometers away from the site of the battle, and we have an exceptionally spectacular clash on the cards. We're unable to get too close in fear of being swept up in the battle, but judging from the current lineups, I can confirm that there are at least 6 Limit Douluo combined in the two sides. There are 4 in the Spirit Pagoda, while Shrek Academy has at least 2. The 4 Limit Douluo of the Spirit Pagoda, the current Spirit Pagoda chairman, Spirit Douluo Kayangi Dongfang, the former Spirit Pagoda chairman, heaven-defying Douluo Kayangi Guiding, his son, Purgatory Douluo Kayangi Kingfang, and the Vice Spirit Pagoda chairman, Heavenly Phoenix Douluo Lang Yaoshu. As for the 2 confirmed Limit Douluo of Shrek Academy, they are Light Dark Douluo Lung Yeyu and Holy Spirit Douluo Yali. As we all know, Yali is currently the number 1 healing system soul master on the continent, and I'm sure many of our viewers have been blessed by her work in the past. Aside from those 2, there is the current Sea Gods Pavilion Master and Tang Sect Master, Dragon Emperor Douluo Tangwulin, who has been rated as the brightest talent of the younger generation. At less than 30 years of age, he's already the leader of these 2 major superpowers, and that's a clear indication of his immense potential. Apparently, he's also a divine blacksmith, and the emergence of a second divine blacksmith after divine blacksmith Senhua is definitely fantastic news for the entire continent. During the previous matches, many of the Shrek Academy representatives have already displayed pieces of 4-word battle armor, and this is undoubtedly going to be a clash of the highest caliber. Due to the fact that this was a live broadcast, the journalists didn't dare to display too much bias even though they had received benefits from the Spirit Pagoda's doing so good spell and into their careers. At this point, the 2 sides were still ascending. All of the previous matches had taken place at altitudes between 300 to 500 meters, but they had already passed 1,500 meters here, and were still showing no signs of stopping. At such a high altitude, sustained flight was impossible below the tidal billow level. There was a saying that altitude above 1,000 meters was a battlefield that belonged solely to mega pilots and salt planes, but the powerful beings of the Spirit Pagoda and Shrek Academy were demonstrating to everyone just how laughable that notion was. Chapter 1628. The reason why both sides were still ascending even after reaching such a high altitude was because they didn't want their clash to affect everyone on the ground below. However, the parents and students on the ground were rather displeased as it was already too far away for them to be able to see anything clearly. They had been elated at the prospect of being able to watch such an epic clash, but their excitement was quickly turning into anxiety. However, right at this moment, 2 giant screens were rolled out of Shrek Academy, and the screens had been switched to the 2 channels that were offering live broadcasts of the clash. With their long distance cameras, an extremely clear image was depicted on the screens. According to our altimeter, both sides have already reached altitudes over 1,600 meters, and they're still continuing to ascend. Are they competing to see who can fly the highest before the match officially begins? As we all know, the higher the altitude, the more sparse the air and the elemental particles are going to be, and this is very detrimental to all soul masters. However, it seems that powerful beings of their caliber are no longer restricted by such factors. I assume the main reason behind their decision to fly so high is so that they can ensure the safety of everyone on the ground below. Pilot, let's fly a bit further away as well. I don't want to be swept up in their clash. We're already over 2 kilometers away. If we go any further, we might not be able to capture clear footage, the pilot replied. It's all right, safety should be our number 1 priority. The host was a huge fan of soul masters, and even though she wasn't a soul master herself, she had a very clear understanding of just how destructive soul masters could be. Tang Wulin's all or nothing had left her with a very deep impression, and she was certain that the power of that attack had exceeded the power of the average 9th grade soul missile. She was in the prime of her life and currently a very popular host, and she certainly had no plans to perish here when everything was going so well for her. However, not everyone was as safety conscious as she was. There were currently 2 other planes situated around 1,500 meters away from the site of the battle, and they felt this to be an absolutely safe distance. Generally speaking, even a 9th grade soul missile's destructive scope only spanned a radius of 1,500 meters. Surely a clash between soul masters couldn't compare with that. After rising to an altitude of around 2,000 meters, both sides finally stopped. At this altitude, the air temperature was far lower than it was on the ground, yet at the same time, the sunlight seemed to be particularly scorching on their skin. Both sides quickly got into their formations. The Spirit Pagoda representatives were led by the trio from the Kayangi family, with Kayangi dieting at the very center, and his 2 sons on either side of him. Behind them were Lang Yaoshu and the Vice Sisters, while the elderly man with the brain martial soul brought up the rear. This was a 3-3-1 formation. There was a majority of assault system soul masters among Limit Douluo, and this was reflected by the Spirit Pagoda representatives, which had an entire team of assault system soul masters aside from the elderly man. As such, the formation that they adopted wasn't all that important. As for the Shrek Academy representatives, they were led by Tang Wulin, and on either side of him stood the middle-aged man and elderly man who were unfamiliar to the Spirit Pagoda. Behind this trio were Light Dark Douluo Lung Yeyu, Holy Spirit Douluo Yali, and that hideous man who was also unknown to the Spirit Pagoda. Xu Xiaowen brought up the rear, and just like the Spirit Pagoda, they had also adopted a 3-3-1 formation. Tang Wulin hovered in midair like an immovable mountain as he held his golden dragon spear in one hand. He and Xu Xiaowen were the 2 youngest Shrek Academy representatives, and they could be extremely proud of themselves for being able to participate in such an epic clash at such a young age. Kayangi Dongfang was looking on with a cold light in his eyes. He wasn't thinking about how to win this match. He was thinking about how he could take advantage of this opportunity to kill Tang Wulin. This young man posed far too much of a threat, and if he were to constantly stay in Shrek Academy, it would be very difficult to kill him. Shrek Academy's new defense system was able to instantly fell a divine grade mecha, and that had truly stunned Kayangi Dongfang. As such, this was the best opportunity to accidentally put an end to Tang Wulin's life. However, this was clearly not going to be an easy task. With Yali present, she would be able to save Tang Wulin as long as he wasn't instantly killed. Tang Wulin raised his golden dragon spear and swiped it through the air, then made an inviting hand gesture. In response, Kayangi Dieting took a step forward, and an indescribably fearsome aura immediately erupted from his body. In that instant, it was as if he had transformed into a gargantuan pillar that was determined to pierce through the earth and pale the entire heavens. In the face of his formidable aura, even the spectators were struck by a sense of fear. Almost all of the live broadcasts were temporarily cut off as Kayangi Dieting's immense aura was affecting the magnetic fields. The hosts of the channels broadcasting this match were stunned to see this, and the planes that were situated no more than 1,500 kilometers away immediately fled further into the distance as quickly as they could. This aura was far too fearsome, and it was only coming from a single person. Standing directly across from Kayangi Dieting, Tang Wulin was facing this aura head on, and he felt as if he were being crushed like an insignificant ant. In response to this enormous pressure, an unyielding will erupted within his heart, and he unconsciously let loose a long roar. At the same time, a giant golden projection appeared behind him, and his blood essence erupted forth in a frenzy as his aura began to elevate at an incredible speed. This was a result of the combination between his golden dragon king bloodline and his own unyielding nature. In that instant, Tang Wulin was able to withstand the fearsome aura of a quasi-god, albeit just barely. Yuan and Zenshen was already preparing to step in, and he couldn't help but give a nod of approval upon seeing this. As a hyper Douluo, Tang Wulin had achieved something that even many Limit Douluos would have been unable to. He truly had an immeasurable future ahead of him. All of a sudden, Tang Wulin flapped his golden dragon wings and flew directly toward Kayangi Dieting. Good heavens! Tang Wulin is taking the initiative to unleash the first attack, and his target is one of the most powerful beings on the entire continent, the quasi-god Kayangi Dieting. Is this a brave and confident strike or one that's completely suicidal? The hosts were all given quite a fright upon seeing this. Wasn't this a team battle? Why was Tang Wulin charging ahead alone? Surely there was no way that this could possibly end well for him. A hint of killing intent flashed through Kayangi Dieting's eyes. He had been paying close attention to Tang Wulin during the previous clashes, and the more he saw, the more alarmed he became. This young man didn't just possess incredible power and potential. What was even more important was that he had intelligence and cunning to match. He had lured Kayangi Dongfang into a one-on-one match, then used a security guard to insult him. Even though he had to concede that match, it prevented Kayangi Dongfang from being able to participate in the 2-on-2 matches. Chapter 1629. No matter how he thought about it, the Spirit Pagoda should have had an absolute advantage in terms of power, but due to Tang Wulin's crafty and cunning arrangements, the 2 sides were evenly matched. He had to die. Thus, Paiang Yudaiding was ecstatic that Tang Wuling was taking the initiative to attack him, and he immediately strode forward with killing intent in his eyes. At the quasi-god level, not only was he able to sense planar laws, he was already able to create some laws of his own to a certain extent, and he possessed masterful control over both space and time. He summoned his coiling dragon staff, and 9 red soul rings instantly appeared around him. That's right, he possessed 9 100,000-year-old soul rings. Regardless of how he had accomplished this, these were 9 genuine red soul rings. He was truly worthy of his title as the most powerful being of the spirit pagoda. The pressure being exerted upon Tang Wuling instantly increased by tenfold, and he felt as if he were being crushed by a force of nature. Paiang Yudaiding's coiling dragon staff then began to expand infinitely in his mind, encompassing the entire sky before crashing down toward him. All of this had happened in the blink of an eye, and Paiang Yudaiding hadn't wasted any time, choosing to unleash a full force attack from the get-go. He was naturally also aware that it wouldn't be easy to kill Tang Wuling with Yali present, so he was going to kill Tang Wuling with a single strike and not give Yali any chance to heal him. This was virtually a clash between the strongest link and weakest link of each side, and Paiang Yudaiding knew that this would be the best opportunity he had to kill Tang Wuling in one fell swoop. This was his signature technique, battling heaven and earth. The attack was far too fast for Tang Wuling to evade, and he could only raise his golden dragon spear to protect himself. Boom. A resounding boom erupted forth alongside powerful shockwaves, and all of the planes that were shooting footage began to tremor violently. A pane of glass had even been shattered on the nearest plane, and it immediately fled in a panicked manner. Immediately thereafter, a golden figure came plummeting out of the sky like a cannonball, crashing heavily down onto the ground in the span of just a few breaths. Another resounding boom rang out, and the earth shattered violently, while Tang Wuling completely disappeared from view. Paiang Yudaiding held his coiling dragon staff with a proud expression. Surely Tang Wuling was dead now. Tang Wuling was indeed more powerful than he had anticipated, but he was still restricted by his cultivation rank. As a quasi-god, Paiang Yudaiding could control the power of heaven and earth in a small area, so that staff strike was the equivalent of an entire small plane slamming into Tang Wuling's body. In the instant that he was struck by the attack, blood gushed out of all of Tang Wuling's orifices, and it was already a testament to his incredible defensive prowess that his body hadn't completely disintegrated. This was the power of a quasi-god, and Paiang Yudongfan's heart was filled with elation, as well as genuine admiration toward his father. He was also a limit Douluo, and his martial soul was also the coiling dragon staff, but he was nowhere near his father's level. He wasn't drawing upon the power of heaven and earth. Instead, he was destroying the power of heaven and earth and forcing it to attack for him. In the eyes of Paiang Yudongfan, his father would have already become a god long ago had it not been for the restriction of the plane. That staff strike had given all of the Shrek Academy representatives a massive fright as well, and the hideous middle-aged man immediately flared up with rage. How dare you? A formidable aura erupted out of his body alongside a string of soul rings as he spoke, and at the same time, a blanket of 5-colored clouds suddenly appeared above the Shrek Academy representatives. Paiang Yudaiding's pupils abruptly contracted upon seeing this. Since when did Shrek Academy have a third limit Douluo? On top of that, he had no recollection of such a limit Douluo at all. In contrast, Yali remained completely calm, and she gently laid a hand on the arm of the hideous man before communicating something to him in a low voice. A hint of surprise appeared on the man's face, and only then did his aura recede slightly. Those 5-colored clouds. Is that another limit Douluo? If so, then this is truly shaping up to be an exciting clash. I wonder how the Dragon Emperor Douluo is doing after being struck by that staff blow. Tang Wuling was currently plunged into a world of complete darkness, and he felt as if his body were a shattered vase. His battle armor, bones, and meridians were all completely destroyed. His defensive prowess was already unmatched in this world, and even without wearing his suit of battle armor, his defensive prowess would definitely outstrip that of the vast majority of people in their battle armor. Even so, the explosive power imbued within that staff strike had completely overwhelmed him. In the past, he had discussed Paiang Yudaiding's powers with Sangxin and Cao Dajia. There was no doubt that Paiang Yudaiding would feature in the clash between Shrek Academy and the Spirit Pagoda. Cao Dajia had told Tang Wuling that Paiang Yudaiding's explosive power was unmatched among all limit Douluos, which meant that no limit Douluo could compare with Paiang Yudaiding in terms of instantaneous explosive power. Tang Wuling wanted to see for himself just how fearsome the most explosive attack on the entire continent was, which was why he had seized the initiative, and sure enough, he had been met by a merciless blow from Paiang Yudaiding. For the first time ever, his golden dragon spear was bent, and it had been bent by Paiang Yudaiding's attack. The golden dragon spear was a divine weapon, so this meant that Paiang Yudaiding's attack was infinitely approaching the godly level. This was immediately followed by the sensation that the world around him had shattered. This wasn't a product of pure destructive power, it was as if a small plane had truly exploded right before him. This was the devastating aspect of the attack, and if it weren't for the fact that Tang Wuling's golden dragon king destructive aura had nullified that part of the attack to a great extent, there was a good chance that his body really would have been blown into pieces. Following that initial clash, Tang Wuling judged Paiang Yudaiding to be slightly more powerful than Infernal King Douluo Harrisa. At Tang Wuling's current cultivation rank, he was still nowhere near powerful enough to challenge such a formidable being. He was going to commit this feeling firmly into his memory and strive toward this direction in his future cultivation. At the same time, the attack had completely stimulated Tang Wuling's unyielding and competitive nature. He never wanted to experience this type of pain again, and what was most worrying of all was that his golden dragon king seals were beginning to loosen again. He felt as if the power within the next seal would immediately erupt forth to control his body if he had even the slightest lapse in concentration. This was the first time he had been injured so severely since he had mastered the body sex congenital secret method. Chapter 1630. Paiang Yudaiding pointed his coiling dragon staff forward and asked, "Who's next? Don't get cocky. I'll be your opponent." A low voice rang out, and the elderly man who had been standing on Tang Wuling's right stepped forward. In contrast with Paiang Yudaiding's aura, which was filled with explosive power, the elderly man resembled an immovable mountain, striking Paiang Yudaiding with the illusion that a mountain was approaching him. The mountain was so tall that he couldn't see its peak, and Paiang Yudaiding's heart immediately jolted upon seeing this. The elderly man had been repressing his own aura this entire time, but now that he was releasing his aura without any reservation, Paiang Yudaiding was finally struck by the realization that this was another limit Douluo. Even more importantly, this was a quasi-god as well. He had always thought that his most formidable opponent would be Light Dark Douluo Long Yeyu. He didn't know whether Long Yeyu was a quasi-god yet, but he had assumed that she had to at least be on the cusp. However, he was confident that he would be slightly more powerful than Long Yeyu. But to his surprise, this unfamiliar elderly man was also a quasi-god. Since when were there so many limit Douluos in this world? Shrek Academy had already displayed 4 limit Douluo, which was already no less than the number of limit Douluo among the Spirit Pagoda representatives. How was this possible? The same thought occurred to both Paiang Yudongfang and Paiang Yudaiding. They thought that they were preying on Shrek Academy, but they were beginning to realize now that they had been tricked. Even if this quasi-god wasn't as powerful as Paiang Yudaiding, there was no way that Paiang Yudaiding would be able to defeat him easily. If Long Yeyu were also a quasi-god, then it would take at least 2 limit Douluo to contend with her, and that would actually leave them at a disadvantage. The only thing in their favor was that Tang Wuling had most likely already been killed by Paiang Yudaiding. Otherwise, it would be quite difficult to predict the outcome of this battle. As things currently stood, the two sides should be evenly matched. There was still another unfamiliar middle-aged man, Xu Xiaoyan, that had to be dealt with, but their control system soulmaster, the elderly man with the brain martial soul, should be equipped to handle them. At the limit Douluo level, the importance of teamwork was significantly diminished, as everyone was simply too powerful individually, and it was quite difficult to try and assist someone else. Paiang Yudongfang immediately transmitted his voice toward his brother. "Big brother, you take on that 5-colored cloud man. I'll go after Yali. I'll try to take her down as soon as possible, then come to assist you." Paiang Yudongfang nodded in response. Yali had just helped him, so he was quite averse to attacking her right away. She was the number one healing system soulmaster on the entire continent. Even though the Spirit Pagoda was constantly trying to destroy Shrek Academy, no one wanted to make her their enemy. Her influence in the soulmaster world was definitely unmatched by any other limit Douluo. Right at this moment, a loud voice rang out among the Shrek Academy representatives. "Paiang Yudongfang, I challenge you." Paiang Yudongfang faltered slightly upon hearing this before casting his gaze toward the owner of the voice, and he was stunned to discover that the one who had challenged him was none other than the middle-aged man who bore a strong resemblance to that quasi-god level elderly man. Surely not. A sense of foreboding immediately welled up in Kaiyang Dongfan's heart. Immediately thereafter, the middle-aged man released a string of 9 soul rings, and a series of mental manifestation projections began to appear around him. This was Shrek Academy's 5th limit Douluo. The hosts of the television stations broadcasting the match had already been stunned into silence. This was downright incredible. Since when did Shrek Academy have 5 limit Douluo? One had to realize that the entirety of Shrek City had been razed to the ground no more than a few years ago. How could Shrek Academy possibly still have 5 limit Douluo among its ranks? Even the Spirit Pagoda was only able to muster up 4 limit Douluo. How is this possible? According to statistical data, there were less than 20 limit Douluo on the entire continent, yet there were already 9 in total gathered here. Furthermore, Shrek Academy's greatest ally, the Tang sect, also had 2 limit Douluo. This meant that the two superpowers had a total of 7 limit Douluo. That was more than the Battle God Hall and Spirit Pagoda combined. Kaiyang Dongfang and Kaiyang Guiding's expressions had darkened significantly at this point. Regardless of whether this man was a rookie or veteran limit Douluo, he was still a limit Douluo. The Bai sisters possessed a soul fusion skill that could rival a limit Douluo, but they wouldn't be able to last very long against a true limit Douluo, and there was no way that their control system soul master could match a limit Douluo in battle. How were they supposed to contend? A shoe-in battle had suddenly turned into a die situation. Kaiyang Dongfang was completely stunned. Wasn't he supposed to be in control here? How did this happen? Kaiyang Guiding asked. May I ask your name? He was a very proud man, but he still had basic respect for powerful beings of the same caliber as himself. Yuan and Zenshin smiled and replied, I'm a new teacher of Shrek Academy and a member of the Sea Gods Pavilion. Yuan and Zenshin. Kaiyang Guiding's expression darkened even further upon hearing this. If he were only an ally that Shrek Academy had temporarily recruited for this match, then he wouldn't be overly concerned, but his heart had immediately sunk upon hearing Yuan and Zenshin declaring himself as a member of the Sea Gods Pavilion. I'm also a new teacher at Shrek Academy, and my name is Yuan and Tiandang. At this vital juncture, the pair of father and son limit Douluos had finally stepped up for Shrek Academy. Some time had already passed since the Yuan and family had moved here, and they had immediately fallen in love with this place. The vast Sea Gods Lake was extremely beautiful, and even though Shrek City no longer existed, they could see the assistance that was pouring in from all sides to support Shrek Academy's reconstruction. Shrek Academy also held them in very high regard, granting them a very large plot of land beside the Sea Gods Lake, and by the time they arrived, all of the basic construction and infrastructure was already complete. Most importantly, Yuan and Zenshin had been granted the opportunity to cultivate beside the Tree of Life 1 day per month. This was an extremely alluring offer for Yuan and Zenshin. Even though it was only 1 day per month, the life energy that was replenished during that 1 day lasted him longer than a month. Thanks so much for watching this video. Don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe. Also leave a comment down below with suggestions on what novels to read.